In our second chapter of cell scripting, we took input from users and then use if-else condition to evaluate certain situations and then output the result based on which condition it satisfied. So today we're going to see the extension of if-else condition, and that is else if, where we can get a little more control of conditions than in if-else only. In case of if else, we evaluate if condition, and if that if condition does not satisfy, then we'll go to else condition. But in case of else if, we need to supply condition in else if as well, and we can have as many as else if as we need. It's like a chain of conditions and goes to next condition to evaluate if the previous condition is not satisfied. So the proper syntax would be so if condition, then commands to execute if this condition satisfies. So in case of else, we do elif. This is else if syntax, and we supply another condition here. In case of else, there was no condition, and then we run more commands, and we can keep on going with else if, then run another commands, and so on. We can go as many as we want. And at the end, you can end with else condition if you want to, but this is optional. You can simply end with else if only. So there's no condition in else, and close if condition. So that would be the normal syntax for else if condition. So let's go and check the script that we tried in our last chapter of cell scripting. So here we took the input from user, number one, we took second input, and then we compared these two numbers. So that is the condition. If first number is greater than second number, then we will print first number is greater than second number message. Else, we just say the first number is smaller. So the problem with this is if we run that script, everything is fine if the first number is greater than the second number, right? And it would also be fine if someone enter second number greater than the first number, then it will say the first number is smaller than second number, which is true. But what if someone enters the same number in both cases? So the condition does not satisfy because 22 is not greater than 22. So it will automatically print that the first number is smaller than the second number, which is not true. So in this kind of situation where you need more control, where you need more conditions, you can use else if condition. So let's try that. We can edit the same command, same script. So here, everything is fine. So this is fine. Now we can use another condition here. So after if, so if this condition does not satisfy, then we'll check another condition, elif. And in that condition, we'll check if number one is less than number two. And if it is, then you can also do it like this. It's not the colon is not a syntax. The semicolon is not a syntax for else if condition. It's just execute two commands in one line. You can also do so in the command line. And the message would be first number is smaller than second number. And if that condition doesn't satisfy, then it has to be the same number, right? If it's not greater than the first, or if it's not the less than the first, then both number has to be the same. Then we can print, they both are same numbers. Let's save it. And now if we execute this program, so 22, 23, first number is smaller than the second number, which is true. Now 23, 22, first number is greater than second number, which is also true. And if we do 22 and 22, so we got more control of the conditions here. So it's a continuation or extension of if condition, but just if you need more control on the condition, if you need to add more conditions, then you'll keep adding else if conditions. And the syntax is, programming is always about making things simple as much as possible. So rather than using multiple elif statement or elif statements, Bash scripting also provides another tool to simplify things, and that is case statements. And case statement also helps you make your script more readable and easier to maintain. And the general syntax of a case statement would be case, then there will be expression, and then space, and then in. This is the syntax. So case one, we'll evaluate, and then we'll execute our statements or commands. Then we do case two, and then more statements or commands. And you can keep going. Case three, another statements. And like if else condition or if condition, if nothing matches, we execute else. In case of case statement, we can also do so by asterisk, which we call default clause, and you can run statements here. And then to close the case, we type reverse case, so ESAC, and that will be the end of case statement. In case of case statement, you can evaluate multiple patterns using pipe sign in case expression, and each statement ends with double colon sign, double semicolon sign, and whichever commands or whichever case it matches, it executes the command of that case, and the case will terminate with the return status of that executed command. And if nothing matches, then it will execute this statement because this is a default clause. Now, if nothing matches here, it will go here, and then it will send the return status of this clause, which is zero because it always matches. So let's try one example. Let's create one file, and then let's do 28. Let's start with the has been, and then we'll go with the example of reading two numbers. Enter the first number, which we will store in variable n1, and then it will say enter another number. Then we'll store in n2. Let's execute some mathematical expression. So we'll go and say echo select m for multiplication, comma a for addition, and S for subtraction. So we are giving a choice to users to input M, A, or S. And based on that condition, we'll execute the command. We could do if and if else here, but let's try with the case. And we will read that value into selection. And now we'll run the case in this selection input. So case selection, and in is the syntax. And now the case is if someone press M, then we'll say echo you selected multiplication, and we can print echo to $n1 multiplied $n2 equals, then actually evaluate the expression, n1 multiplied by n2, and close the bracket. Now close this case. And if the case is someone pressed A, then we'll say echo you selected addition, and then we can say, let's copy this one, Alt 6, Control U, then we can say addition here. That will be the text to display and actual algebra here. And if someone press S, then you can say you selected subtraction. And then we can do Control U. And in case of subtraction, we can just display first number minus second number, and then do the subtraction. So close that case. And if nothing matches, if user does not input MAS, then we can go to the default clause and say, we can give information like valid selection, enter M, A, or S only, for example. and finally close this case. So let's save it. Now let's make it executable. So enter the first number, 4. Enter the second number, 5. Select M for multiplication. Okay, let's try multiplication. Okay, you selected multiplication, 4 multiplied by 5 is 20, which is great. And we'll do another test, 4, 5. Now A for addition, you selected addition, and 4 plus 5 is 9, which is also great. Now let's do subtraction, 9, then 6, then do S. 9 and subtract 6 is 3, which is all true and works great, right? But the problem is, what if someone press, oh, actually we didn't try, let's press something else. I pressed U. Invalid selection, enter M, A, or S only, right? Which is working as we wanted. So now let's run it again, 5. And then 4. And then what if someone says lowercase m or a? It says invalid selection, but that's not true because we selected m, right? Someone might select a lowercase m. So for that, we can go and change our script a little bit. So I told you that you can use multiple pattern in case using pipeline. So you can do m or m. So if user press m, lowercase or uppercase, you execute the same command. You can do same, or you can also do this one. Now let's save it. Now if we run 4, 5, and I select M, now multiplication. Now it's working as we wanted. And same thing for addition too. And same thing for subtraction. And if you press anything else, it should simply say unknown. So I press T, invalid selection, which is fine. Now user can get more clever and try to crash this script by pressing something that we do not want, for example. So in case of number, what if somebody pressed T, letter? And what if somebody pressed U on the second number? Then T multiplied by U is equal to 0. So this is not something we wanted. So what we can do is we can change our script a little bit more and force user to input numbers instead of letters. And if someone enters letters, then we can just exit from the program. Okay, let's do that. So after reading the number, what we can do is we can check here the number, and to do that we can use another case statement. So in case of number 1 in, we can also check for the empty string. You cannot put empty string, or you cannot put a non-digit number. So let's do that with the regular expression. If it's not 0 and 9, then we can simply say echo please enter the number, not the character, right? And if somebody does that, we can simply exit 1, meaning we can produce general error and send that status code to the bash, and we can close this case and just exit out of the program. And we can do the same thing for second number. So let's copy this one, Alt 6, and we can go to here, paste that one, Control U. So we just change this little bit, N2, and same thing, right? Case is closed, then we go for the selection. Okay, looks good. Now let's execute, same input. So if someone enter T, please enter the number, and the case is closed, and the program is terminated with the status code of 1. What if someone says 4 and T? Same thing, please enter the number, because that our regular expression demands the number, full number. And it also checks against empty string inputs. So this is very simple and basic idea of if else if condition, and finally case statements. So case statements is like a switch if you are familiar with other programming languages, but in case of case statement, it does not go and look for another case to match once it finds the matching case, and it will execute and return the status code of that command, and the case will be terminated. You will see many bash commands using case statements. For example, start or stopping of services or sending signals using PID, etc. So this is our third chapter for cell scripting. First was introduction to cell script. Second was taking input from users, and then if condition, if else condition. And this is our third, where we discussed else if condition and case statements. So from the knowledge that you gather in these three chapters, you can try and do something of your own and do some useful scripting. Maybe just create some utilities that you need, like backup your data and stuff like that. So I hope this video was helpful to you, and I'll continue our cell scripting in future videos as well. Thanks for watching. Thanks for being with me on this video, and I'll see you in my next video. Take care.